welcome back, YouTubers. Here we are, Andy's Armour again. I've got my M249 here today. This is a gun that I have had for many years. And I've done a few bits to it in previous times, obviously when I was learning about all the guns, taking them apart, experimenting, sort of finding out how it all works and everything. I have upgraded the hop-up chamber in this previously. It's got one of the Bullgear hop chambers in it, which is a massively worthwhile upgrade on one of these because the original ones are just trash. And I had done some stuff previously in the gearbox to sort of make it fire how I wanted it to. So we'll see if what I did years ago is going to keep me happy now. I don't know. Obviously, I've learned a lot more since that time ago. So we'll see if I feel I need to change anything from what I'd previously done. Another thing I did find with these is that's not the original magazine. So this is an A&K M249, the Para one. The original magazine that came with it, it used to jam up, it used to clog up, it was horrendous. So this is actually a classic army mag, and that has been absolutely bulletproof. That fits perfectly. It's been absolutely fine for the time I've had it. In no way do I want that to be a representation of what might they might be like nowadays, because as I say, it was years ago. Things may well have changed. Or I might have been unlucky and had a bad one. So yeah, other than that, this one's been perfect. Right, this thing's huge, so we're just going to have to bear with it. It's not all going to fit in the camera at once, unfortunately. So, take it apart. Now, these are quite simple to take apart. To release the barrel, I like to push it kind of in to support it, and then it's just pushing that up, and that just releases. There we go, so there's the Bullgear hop. Come back to that later. Now on the back of mine, I'm missing the side clips which used to go in here to release it. So I've just got it held by a bit of wire that I've managed to bodge around it. It works, so yeah, just that's how I've always used it. So let's pull the pin out. Now these are horrendous, watching them get fingers caught under that, because that is lethal. I've had it a few times where it comes down on your fingers and it's not fun. There. That is as simple as it is to get the gearbox out on these things. So that is that stripped, we don't need the body anymore. We're left with gearbox and barrel, which is the bits we want for now. Right, this is the gearbox on the 249, obviously very different to many other gearboxes you might see out there. It's quite unique in its own sort of shape and form, but in many ways it's similar in the way it works. Oh, see what we'll do actually, I have to take the spring out before I do this, because it's all quick change. Right, so I've just finished doing a bit of reshimming on the gears. Now there was a couple of things I did change over what I had done years ago when I first did it. And I think partly because of that is because I've got finer shims now, much smaller scale ones, which allow me to make finer adjustments. And also something I hadn't noticed years ago when I did it is I've now flared the bottom of these teeth on this gear. I don't know if you can see it. But I've had the Dremel out and I've flared them up ever so slightly, and the reason for it is in here the bushings don't sink completely into the gearbox shell, and that I noticed on opening it this time. The very bottom of those teeth was just catching, which was causing a little bit of resistance, but now they are really smooth with the new shimming. So finer adjustments on the actual shims themselves, some repositioning of everything, and flaring the bottom of that is really what I've done in that to make that better. So this has previously been upgraded with a Bullgear hop-up chamber, purely because the original A&K hop chambers in these was horrendous. It was a similar design, but the way the nub worked, it had a small metal ball on a spring, and there was just no flexibility in it, and it was just too rough on the hops, in the sense of having no flex as the BB goes through it. You could very easily jam your shots up if you put your hop up on too much, and then a slight change in the hop up wasn't on enough, so it was horrendous. But these things, in my opinion, they are the way forward when you're upgrading the hop chambers in these. This one's obviously been in here a while. I can tell because the O-ring that I've got around the back here, don't think the camera's going to focus, but that is so perished. So that we can replace. That was put on there just to sort of keep that solid, firm, if you will. Once you set it, it doesn't move with the vibrations of the gun shooting. And at the minute, it's just got a standard hop-up rubber on it, so we'll upgrade that to the usual. Maple leaf gives it a bigger contact pad. That should make it more efficient in lobbing the BBs. So yeah, let's give it a clean up. So dry, that hot rubber. That's been in there years. Okay, so just for comparison purposes, that is the original hop up chamber in there. So obviously identical in shape, obviously they would need to be. The difference being is the little hole there used to have a little ball bearing in it, which when that rotated, that pushed down on the hot rubber, and was just either too harsh or not harsh enough, and was pain in the backside to get correct. Whereas that, they've modified it very cleverly, so it still has the same wheel system, but we're now moving a hop arm, which is so much more effective, and it means you can use proper nubs with it as well. So yeah, that's why I chose that one, and it's been absolutely brilliant, and I hope it's going to be even better with a new hot rubber in it. And we're just going to put a new O-ring in that gap so it holds that on, and it also makes that stiff to turn. So it means once the hop's set, it's not going to rotate during the functioning of the gun. Right, all back together, brand new hop-up rubber installed, so that's all ready to go. Little service on the gearbox whilst we're in there, some small adjustments to the shim positions, so everything's going to run as smooth as it can do. Just a chrono test to do. This is running on 0.32s using an 11.1 volt battery. There you go. 276 on a 0.32, that is 1.13 joules, and we have a rate of fire of about 20 rounds a second. So yeah, I'll take that for a support weapon. Quite happy with the result there. So yeah, that I think is another one done.